The Georgia Bulldogs and the Tennessee Volunteers set to get together here in Knoxville.
A lot of legends walking around here.
Welcome to the place where you belong. This is how legends are born.
Manning throws at the end zone.
Touchdown!
Dobbs heaves it.
Caught Juwan Jennings!
Did you see what he did? We just stepped on their face with a hobnail boot.
Hand off to Herschel. He's running over people.
He ran right through two men.
Attacked, attacked, attacked. Make them remember you as long as they live.
You understand? We hunt today.
I want to break the rear.
Holy drilling!
Nowhere to run and nowhere to hide for four quarters.
Relentless effort wins out every single time. Keep coming at him.
Down he goes.
All right, go show him what a volunteer is. Everybody got me?
Yes, sir. This is how legends are born.
Here come the defending national champion Georgia Bulldogs.
This is how legends are born.
The power T opening up. You ready?
Can't wait.
It's football time in Tennessee. What better way to bring us into Neyland Stadium one last time than the legendary voice of John Ward? It is indeed football time in Tennessee. On a beautiful November afternoon, the Home Depot SEC on CBS brings us with 102,000 of our closest friends and our matchup. The 18th-ranked Volunteers of Tennessee against the number one team in the country, the Georgia Bulldogs. Welcome you, everybody. Brad Nessler with Gary Danielson. Gene Steratore is in the booth with us today. Jenny Dell down on the sideline. Partner, the regular season is just two games from ending. For a lot of teams, it'll be the end of their season. For a lot of teams, they'll be wondering where they're going bowling. For Georgia, they're chasing history. What they've done has been nothing short of remarkable. Look at the lineup here. Alabama's done it twice at 28 straight wins. Georgia can match that if they win today. And we've been a part of a lot of those games.
Sure
has. It's really been something to watch.
It really has. I mean, they've just incredible elite play. But today's going to be a different challenge. Remember, this is only the third road game in the SEC that Tennessee has played, and this will be by far the toughest venue. And Tennessee has their own streak.
Yeah.
14 in a row here at home. However, the bad news is the last loss was to Georgia.
That's right. Georgia's played incredible football. 10-0 for the third straight year. A perfect 10 for their quarterback, too. And he needs some recognition. I think Carson Beck has been sensational as we see him warming up down on the field. A model of consistency. Five games over 300 yards passing. Every game, 250 yards or more passing. And look how it matches up with
and
the guy.
That was the question mark.
Right.
Could he replace Stetson Bennett? That what the Georgia fans talked about all offseason. Obviously, he stepped and done it. And now he's got a familiar face. I think the pressure point of this Georgia football team, back and healthy, Brock Bowers. In college football, when you have one of those special players, he makes everything go. The running game, the passing game. He's as good at his position as anybody in college football is at theirs. That's where Tennessee has to start, stopping number 19, and then go from there.
Well, we've seen Joe Milton play well. We've seen Joe Milton have subpar games. He can't have a subpar game today.
No way they can beat Georgia with a subpar game from their quarterback, or any other team for that matter. We've seen some good things from Joe. He's improved as the season has gone on. He has not pitched that complete game yet. But to do that against Georgia, we know what their Georgia defense is like. And to be that way and to blow that kiss, he's going to need help from that offensive line. That's Cooper Mays, his center. That offensive line must be ready to play their most physical football game of the year, or they will not win.
Tennessee through the power T, and here come the Volunteers. And you can tell by the booze, Here comes the number one team in the country. And there's one of the best football players in the country. With more on him, Jenny Dell.
27 days. That is how long Georgia was without their star talent in Brock Bowers. Now, he took me through the miraculous timeline of his return to football. It all started back on October 14th when he had that left ankle injury. Now, 2 days later, he had tightrope surgery. Bowers took the next 5 days completely off before starting PT. Some weight training, eventually some light jogging. And by the 26th, just 10 days post-surgery, he started running. Now, he returned to action last Saturday against Ole Miss, exactly 4 weeks after the injury. He wasn't 100% in making cuts at game speed, but the ankle felt good and it continues to improve. Now, Carson Beck told me, "I've always said Brock is superhuman, and the fact that he came back that fast proves the statement to be true." Guys, he said 19's return makes his job a whole heck of a lot easier.
Boy, of all the remarkable things we've seen out of Brock Bowers, maybe the most remarkable, what Jenny just talked about, after the tightrope surgery, back in uniform, a lot of people, well, people around the country that didn't know Brock Bowers thought maybe that was the end of his career. Obviously can go into the NFL if he chooses to do so. But he's back and he's a huge part of an undefeated team again. Kirby Smart, 91 wins in his eighth season. Not bad. And 27 straight, as we talked about. And on the other side, Josh Heupel, his third year, 25-11, and his stay in Knoxville so far. He's only lost back-to-back games twice in his head coaching career.
And when we met with him Friday, you could still see the steam coming out of his ears about that game versus Missouri.
They laid an egg last week, and we saw it in person. They don't want to have that happen today. It's a Chamber of Commerce day in Knoxville. Beautiful November afternoon. The 53rd meeting all time between the Vols and the Dogs. Georgia with the advantage, 27-23. There was a couple of ties. This is the latest they've met since 1906 here on, what is it, November 18th? 102,000. They've been gearing up for a couple days. Everybody's had this game circled on their calendar since the preseason, including CBS. Georgia won the toss and deferred. Jared Zirkel will kick. D. Williams, Camera Selden back deep. Here we go. And Tennessee will bring it out to the 25-yard line as we take a look at our lineups presented by Papa John's as we follow out Joe Milton. 14 straight games with a touchdown pass. He'd like to keep that going here today. The rest of the offense joining Joe looks like this. Jacob Warren tied for number two in touchdown receptions on the team. Their sixth year super senior tight end. Jalen White. To the races and maybe gone. Jalen Wright, one snap, touchdown, Tennessee.
Georgia, watch this hole. Cooper Mays with the block, 63, and off and running, and they did not come close to catching him. What a start. That's the eighth game that Georgia has scored on their opening drive. Not as good as that one, though.
75 yards and 11 seconds, good. Extra point, good. This place just erupted. much like the hole that Gary talked about off the right side. Here's another look.
Javonte Sprague, it's number 76, and Cooper Mays, number 63. They get the key blocks. Where were those inside linebackers? Remember the injury that Georgia had with Dubus Johnson not playing inside.
C.J. Allen, the freshman, he's on the other side.
Watch it right here. What happens? Overrun inside by Mondin that time. Picked the wrong hole, and he was off and going.
Believe it or not, that's not the longest touchdown run for Jalen Wright. He had an 82-yarder earlier this year, but he'll take that one.
And remember how frustrated he was a week ago. Had nothing in the, what did he get,
22 yards
in that game.
Well, you can't start any better.
No. And Tennessee hoped to get that crowd involved early.
They got it.
Job one is done.
That's Turboville. The kickoff. Georgia will come out with 25.
It happened so fast I had to find my telestrator. I didn't even know where it was.
Last week, Tennessee had 83 rushing yards. They've got 75 in the first 11 seconds
amazing.
Of the game.
Just amazing.
And our Papa John's lineup, Carson Beck, who we talked about a couple minutes ago, brings him out. His numbers sensational on the year.
Just so ironic. We talked about that Tennessee offensive line had to be physical for them to have a chance. They showed they are ready. Georgia will be in for a fight.
Dejon Edwards with Carson Beck in the Georgia backfield. Going to be a quick throw, wide receiver screen. Actually, not a wide receiver. Brock Bowers, who's playing like a wide receiver a lot of the time. So his first catch on the first play for Georgia in their offense. Amarius Mims, having him back, really opened things up. Not only over 600 yards of offense, 300 yards on the ground last week in their win over Ole Miss. They're all SEC tackle, wearing number 77 in honor of Devin Willock today. Here's Dejon Edwards, and he blasts his way for a first down across the 35.
So one of the things Georgia has experienced this season is being behind in football games. They, as Brad told you in the open, are champs, and they've done it over the years. If anybody can handle this early explosion, you would think Georgia would.
Timeout for an injured player.
Got a guy down for Tennessee. Jordan Thomas, the man down, the secondary. They can't afford to lose any secondary players.
They can't afford to lose anybody. They've been thin almost all across their front on offensive line, wide receivers. I mean, they've gotten hit at different spots all year for this. When we were talking to Josh Heupel, yesterday, he said it's one of those years with injuries.
Last year they stayed healthy and obviously had a sensational season. This year not so much on the health. And we'll see if Jordan can come back in. Meanwhile, that's a first down.
Just another point why this is the third SEC road game for Georgia. Remember the neutral site game. This is the year in the odd year that they only play 3 road games. So this setting, this type of game, they really haven't experienced it much this year. Auburn early, but that was a rebuilding team.
Straight up the middle, Dylan Bell. Against the Tennessee defense, that looks like this. Tank McCullough, not only leads the team in interceptions, he'll have to be an excellent tackler in the back end if Georgia gets into the secondary, and he has been good at that over his time at Tennessee. Dejon Edwards back in on a second down at 6. Carson back. Good pocket, good throw, and catch. First down at the 40-yard line. So he got it to Ra-Ra Thomas.
Right tackle, Amarius Mims. He's back, he's healthy. That means they have 3 tackles. Watch right here, he's wearing 77 in honor of Devin Willock. And this time he handles the pass rush and allows that crossing route to get across the field.
Back to the ground, Dejon Edwards for about 3. He's their leading rusher coming in. Came in just under 700 yards. And is over that now with a couple of carries today. And we talked about, Gary mentioned it, trailed in 10 games during the 27-game winning streak. I think every time we've had them this year, they got behind, didn't they?
Absolutely. As Kirby preaches, just one moment. He doesn't go one play. It's one moment at a time he preaches to his team.
Empty backfield on second down and 7. Five receivers, for Carson Beck. Comes near side, incomplete, intended for Rosemead Jack Saints. And some of the close calls during the 27-game winning streak. College football championship to trail Missouri in the fourth quarter. Trailed Ohio State big time. That looked like it was a lost cause and came back to win. Tied with Auburn in the fourth quarter and won it 27-20. Down only 7-0 here, but the crowd is totally into it just 3 minutes into the game. Courtesy of a 75-yard touchdown on the first snap for the Vols.
So here's where Tennessee needs to win right here. Third down. They want to make an impact.
Georgia's the best third down team in the country at 56%. On 3rd and 7, Beck on the slant, got it to Brock Bowers, first down.
Yeah, very aggressive that time from Tim Banks. They brought 6 players, which means man-to-man. They've got the matchup they like on the outside. Brock Bowers, plenty of space to get it to. Easy slant inside. Look at the good protection and perfect throw.
Two tight ends in there now, Bowers and Oscar Delp. He's going to be a good one, too. Already is.
Yeah, we saw him, didn't we? One-handed catch.
Yep. That's Ladd McConkey in motion. Kendall Milton in the backfield for Georgia. The ball is out. Beck covered it, mishandled it, and had to eat it.
So that's what this Tennessee defense did not produce a week ago against Missouri. Negative plays. This time it was a self-inflicted wound. Ken Milton and Carson Beck just did not handle the play-action scheme well at all. A gift to the Senate Tennessee defense.
No doubt, and a big loss, and that's 2nd down and 18. 3 wide-out group. That's McConkey in motion again to the top of your screen. Beck looks that way, goes that way.
Ooh. Man, he gunned that.
Bowers couldn't handle it.
I thought he had a chance to catch that ball. This was a fastball in between the combo defense. Jalen McCullough was the closest player right here that could have made a play. He's got what he wants, and it's bio. I thought that should have been a caught football right there.
That had some smoke on it.
Plenty of time to adjust, but we've seen that guy make those catches his whole career.
Yep. It's 3rd down and 18. Beck's going to keep it. Now the quarterback run, and apparently there was a whistle I didn't hear.
I think that Tennessee took a timeout.
Prior to the snap, timeout, Tennessee. It is their first.
So not quite 5 minutes into the game. We'll take the timeout with them. If you're just joining us, Tennessee already in front by a touchdown.
Want to see where your team stands? Just tell Siri, show me the college football rankings.
Well, coming in, we knew that something had to give today here in Knoxville, be it Georgia's long winning streak of 27 or Tennessee's home winning streak of 14. They're off to a good start. 1 play, 1 touchdown for the Volunteers offense. 7-0, and now Georgia at the 36-yard line. And Carson Beck was going to keep it on a quarterback run.
Interesting. Both teams, the offense and defense, kind of tipped their hand. Tennessee dropped into a deep zone, and Georgia was trying to get closer for a field goal. Right. Now what does each side do? They reshuffled the deck.
Peyton Woodring's longest field goal this year for Georgia is 48 yards for the freshman. 3rd and 18. This will be a throw. And it's complete. Brock Bowers. And Bowers diving inside the 25.
Yeah, same kind of
desire in this play. Let's get it closer for a field goal. Not likely to pick up the first down, quarterback draw, or throw it to your tight end and put it into a manageable field goal shot.
You just put it in range of him and he's going to make the catch.
But he could have made that other one. That would have been close to a first down. Can't catch them all. I get that. But that was, I think, smart play by Mike Bobo. Both sides, defensive coordinator for Tennessee, did the same thing.
This freshman was a little shaky at the beginning of the year, but now he's a Groza semifinalist. For 42 yards away, and he's got it. Good for Georgia. They're on the board.
Yeah, nice answer by the Georgia football team. They get shocked. They get knocked down with a knockout punch in the first round. They get off the canvas and get 3 points.
Peyton Woodring, his 19th successful field goal of the year. It's 7-3 Vols. We packed a lot of action into 5 minutes. 7-3, Georgia, 11-play drive, covered 51 yards before the field goal. And now Dee Williams and Cameron Seldon wait back inside the five. Jared Zirkel to kick for the second time. This one won't be returnable either. Let's take you back to the first snap and the only snap for Tennessee.
You know, we mentioned the linebackers on the first go around. Smile Munden, number two, kind of hits the left gap. C.J. Allen, the true freshman, picks the wrong gap. But 23, Tyke Smith, and you would think Javon Bullard, your two safeties, would take a play and lay. Okay, they got 10 yards, but they don't go the distance. You depend on Bullard right in the middle of the field to make that play, and he did not.
Georgia, no road games against top 25 teams. 25-yard line. Can Jalen Wright do it again? I don't think so. A little bit of a stiff arm. Maybe got a yard out of that. Run out by Tyke Smith, who Gary just mentioned, as we haven't even had a chance to set the Georgia defense. C.J. Allen, guy that was victimized, or at least one of the linebackers. Yvonne Dumas Smith out with a broken forearm, and so the freshman forced into that spot.
You had him highlighted to say something great about him.
Yeah, well, he had 9 tackles in the sack last week, so.
That's bad luck.
Yeah. And I don't know if that was a middle screen, but Joe Milton caught his own pass. Milton to Milton, and Milton to the corner. Pickup of about 9.
Well, remember, the Georgia defensive line had an interception, and here they almost potentially got another one. You can't throw it again. One forward pass per play gets batted down. It was a middle screen. And actually, I think they hit the helmet of an offensive lineman on the play.
Milton fires out Squirrel White. No gain on that one.
So to set up this third and short, one more look at the play inside, and yes, it did hit the helmet of his own player.
His ear's going to be ringing for a while.
And that was their only positive play on that series, by the way, a 3-and-out. Had the first down run for nothing. That one was a kind of deflection for a positive play, and then you saw the Georgia secondary tackle kind of the way they were used to it on that last play.
Yeah. The truck kidding around with us a little bit, Joe Milton's first career reception. He's one for one to himself. Jackson Ross to punt. Guy News has it around the 34-yard line. With 8:14 remaining in the first quarter, Georgia on offense for the second time when we come back. Stay in the know with CBS Sports HQ, the 24/7 free network that brings you the latest news, picks, scores, and highlights from all the sports you love. Watch CBS Sports HQ anywhere, anytime, all the time. And I'm going to join the HQ gang after our game here in Knoxville today.
They love you when you do those Bulldog wrap-ups. That's your special.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. It's always a dog day when I'm on with the HQ group.
We're talking about the Tennessee team being mixed with injuries. Their two starting safeties, Demarion McDonald and Wesley Walker, neither one of them are on the field.
From the 35, McConkey in motion. It's a toss sweep to John Edwards. John gets about five before he's run out of bounds as we check in with Jenny.
Well, Gary just mentioned that Wesley Walker is out. Now, Vol safety Jordan Thomas, he was injured at the beginning of the game. He spent some time in the injury tent. During commercial, he did some running drills on the sideline, dropped down in pain, and went into the locker room. Guys, it is a hip injury. He's questionable to return.
All right, Jenny, thanks. I was just wondering about that. Thin in the secondary. Toss sweep left side. Nice play.
Yep.
Getting in to make the stop, Andre Turrentine.
And that's the backup for Wesley Walker that time, making the play on the stretch. Back-to-back toss sweeps handled well by that secondary. Remember the success that Missouri had running the edge of this Tennessee defense last week?
Yep.
I'm not surprised Georgia tested it, and the answer has come with that tackle right there. Third down.
Third down and six from the 39. McConkey's been on the run motion-wise most of this first quarter. Haven't thrown toward him yet. Beck going to try to run for it. Stumbling, but getting it as he got out to the first down.
That was one of the questions I had about a bit of a difference from this Georgia offense from Stetson Bennett to Carson Beck. Stetson has been very good against Tennessee, scrambling and on running plays. That weapon in this offense, Tennessee thought they had more of a guy they could rush and he'd be kind of a statue in the pocket. Didn't happen on that play.
Carson told us earlier this year, I'm a little more athletic than everybody thinks I am. Good run there to pick up the first down, move the sticks out across the 45 and the 47. Kendall Milton comes into the Georgia backfield. Had a huge game last week in the win over Ole Miss.
Yeah, with him healthy, it brings a power attack from this Georgia offense.
We'll get the carry. Only got about a yard. Tripped up. Milton, career high. 127 yards in that victory over Ole Miss, it is, including two touchdowns. Elijah Herring dropped him after just a yard gain on the last one, second down and nine. Brock Bowers on a wing on the left side. Dominique Lovett settles in on the right. Back here comes a blitz. Fires. Got an open man. Complete. This Rosamie Jack Saints. First down, Georgia.
One of the problems of handling this offense for Georgia is you have no idea where they're going to attack you or which player is going to be the attack weapon. You could literally throw it to 10 different players in this offense. They come from all different angles. They substitute freely. And if you're back there trying to play defense, you have no idea who's getting the ball.
21-yard pickup on that one and a first down at the 31-yard line. Only about a yard for Milton again.
Back-to-back plays with that Tennessee defensive line. Was able to be stout enough against what Georgia believes is the strength of their football team, that offensive line.
Georgia's offensive line up for the Joe Moore Award again as the top offensive line in the country, running against guys like Omari Thomas, who plugged that hole. Big number 21.
Xavier Truss is in at left tackle, a rotation of three players up front. Truss in for, I believe it's Otis Green.
Second and nine. Ajon Edwards, nice cut. It's going to bring up a third down, though, and about five to go. As we're down to the 4.5 minute mark, first quarter.
Georgia's number one in the country in third down conversions.
Yep. Excuse me, Gary.
I think he stumbled back. I don't think anything's wrong. He just stumbled backing up. Yep. There it is.
It's going to happen once in a while. Turf monster.
I think he tripped over. I think he tripped over Simmons, number 10.
At any rate, we got everybody set back up almost. Dylan Bell in at a wide receiver spot. Plays in a lot of different positions for Georgia. He's wide to the right. Third down and five. Back. Quick throw.
You got to get your hands up.
Or you're going to take it right in the kisser.
Absolutely. This is a fastball again. He knows it's a zone look, kind of a matchup zone to the outside. So he's throwing in those holes, and he's ripping it into there.
Brock Bowers is going to turn around his head. Whoops, got it.
I don't know if he saw it or heard it coming.
There was a whistling sound, and he put his hands up in self-defense. First down, fourth catch for Brock. That's Oscar Delp, the other tight end in motion. Here's a toss.
You throw it.
And Dylan Bell lofts it out there to a wide open. Rosamie Jack Saint. Touchdown, Georgia.
We'll hand that one to Mike Bobo. A lot of different weapons. And this time they use one of them to throw it. Mike Bobo with the call. Engineered two great drives after the shock. Dylan Bell, a little bit of everything, as Ness told you when he comes in the game. This time his little bit is a lot.
Wow. That's being wide open. Rosamie Jack Saints, third touchdown catch of the year. 18 yards.
The last 2 years, this team is built around defense. This Georgia team is built around their offense.
Wittering in for the point after. Up and good. Well executed Georgia drive. 65 yards in 9 plays. Mr. Do Everything, Dylan Bell, throws it out there. Rosamie Jack saying it's 10-7 Georgia. Mike Bobo, good call. Streaming live on Paramount Plus.
How about a great finish for CBS here in the regular season? We get to do this game and needless to say, then get finish up in the Iron Bowl. Can't get better than that.
And the SEC Championship game. Two pretty good teams there.
That'll be fun.
Fourth passing touchdown by a non-quarterback. And Dylan Bell, reception to Rosamie Jack Saints. Let's check in. Adam Zucker in our New York studio, Jeep Update. Zuck, what do you got?
Yeah, Ness, Iowa may not have to wait until Thanksgiving Friday to clinch the Big Ten West. They got a 2-0 lead on Illinois in the bottom of the first. Joe Evans coming through with the sack. And 2-0, Hawkeyes on top, their third safety of the season. That might be enough to get it done today with that defense.
Only Iowa can do that.
It would be beautiful to have it done that way. Clinch the West 2-0. That would be great. I don't know who their starting pitcher is for the Big Ten Championship.
Well, Tennessee's first drive, 1 play, 75 yards. Their second drive, 3 plays, 8 yards. And now they lost yards on that snap.
That was a called quarterback draw that time. And it was stuffed. I think it was Makai Williams, number 13. It was in their first.
Getting held, by the way.
Yeah, getting held, but it didn't matter because there was three dogs right behind him.
Loss of 4, second down and 14. That squirrel white in motion. Keep it on the ground. Jabari Small. Nice move by Jabari Small.
Put it in position to pick up third down and short or medium right here.
Got about 12 on that deal. Look at that move.
And that offensive line, even with the injuries up front, continue to stay with their man. We talked to Kirby about this, his defense. It's engage and then get rid of him. The Tennessee offensive nine would not allow it.
So now they got a manageable third down, 45% on the year on their third down conversions. Joe Milton will throw for it here. And had that one tipped, incomplete. Might have been Michael Williams again.
It was. He's had a pretty good series here, and it's going to force a punt. Keon Gamble here. Timed out well, just enough pressure to get inside and get his hand
up. Number one for Georgia is 28, and number 11 for Georgia is now 27.
Georgia with some jersey changes being announced there. Fourth down, and Jackson Ross to punt. Doesn't matter which way he goes. He can kick with both feet. This time it's a left. Kind of a nice weapon to have, depending on where you want to place the ball. He places it in Makai Mew's hands down around the 26-yard line. With a couple minutes remaining in the first quarter. Take a look at the Dr. Pepper SEC standings. Take a look at the East. You can forget about East and West starting next year, but here's how it looks already. Georgia has clinched again. They'll make another appearance in Atlanta. The championship game against Alabama. Who already clinched the West. They're 10-1 after their win today. So the Clash of Titans, first Saturday in December in Atlanta at the Benz.
And Ness, with that back-to-back three and outs, by Georgia. That means the plays are mounting up 19-7. It could already be affecting this Tennessee defense early in this court game.
Georgia from the 27. Play action. Beck got some heat. Steps up, fires, and it's intercepted. Picked off by Danico Slaughter. Going the other way. Georgia finally brings him down, but he's in the red zone with a pick. Boy, for a kid from Roswell, Georgia, that's got to feel pretty good in that Tennessee uniform. Slaughter's first interception of the season.
That is Tate Ratledge right there, number 69, the right guard. Played all year at that
prior
spot.
Prior to the pass, holding zero on the defense.
A 10-yard penalty
from the previous spot. The result of the foul is an automatic first down.
That was Danico Slaughter.
He did a little bit of everything on that
yes,
play.
Yes, he did.
Well, erase the pick.
The only thing you're not going to erase is the injury to Tate Ratledge right there. This ball was slightly overthrown, but the holding had to happen before the ball was thrown. Let's watch it right here. There's the matchup.
Working against Arian Smith.
Yeah, I didn't see much there. Okay, he didn't impede his run at all. He had his hands on him, no doubt.
Gene Steratore is with us in the booth as I turn around to look at him. Gene?
Yeah, you know what, Brad? There's a little hand fighting there. I saw one little quick grab of the jersey with the left hand, but really, 11 White has also got his hands up in there. Didn't look really big to me, guys.
It appeared like he slowed him down, but remember, Carson Beck was not throwing to him. He was throwing to the crossing route. A big break for Georgia.
Georgia's going to move Amarius Mims into...
Well, I would think they'd move Xavier Trust. That's where he started out.
Let's see.
At left guard. I would think he would start get back to left guard. No, they're going Morris. Michael Morris, 56, the regular backup at left guard.
All right, so that's the line for Georgia right now. Take away the interception. First down at the 37. Big pileup for Milton after a two-yard gain.
Huge call. And remember, this Tennessee team has been making a lot of penalties, especially at home.
You're not supposed to have them at home.
No, they are actually ranked 130th in the country coming in, averaging 9 penalties a game. Yeah, you can see the pull right there. That is a good call. That's a great look. The last look, I think even Tennessee fans would agree with that one. That was the definitive call right there. The definitive look, excuse me.
Brock Bowers will settle in on the slot on the right-hand side on a second down and 8 from the 39. Beck getting a little bit of pressure again. And throws incomplete, intended for Lovett. And it'll be third down. Crowd is going to get loud at Neyland.
So Georgia substituted and allowed Tennessee to put their fast rush team on the field. They've substituted 4 defensive linemen. James Pierce being one of them, number 27.
Third down and 8. Flags fly in. Both teams pointing in the other direction. It's going to be against Georgia for the false start.
False start. Offense number 63. 5-yard penalty. Remains third down.
Cedric Van Brand there, all SEC center.
No real movement up front.
Right there. The lean.
Yeah, and he starts leaning. Once you start, the big guy starts to lean, it's over.
You can't stop the lean. Not at 300 plus. Third and 13.
Can't hide it either.
Carson Beck comes up to communicate with his offensive lineman. Dejon Edwards trying to do the same.
See how conservative they are here. A punt wouldn't be the worst thing for Georgia.
Look out from behind. Pass is complete to Edwards, but he's going to be stopped at the 39.
Yeah, that was good defense by Tennessee. Lay way back. You knew Georgia would not make a throw that put any type of interception on the books. Gets the pressure from the outside. gets rid of it, check down. It's exactly, that's a defense wins.
And so Georgia will have to punt. Brett Thorson will come out to kick it away. It might have to wait until the second quarter will defend. Georgia has not allowed a punt return this year. One of only three teams in the country that can make that claim. And Thorson takes his time to kick it away. Going to take a Georgia bounce inside the 15. They still haven't allowed a punt return this year.
And kills the rest of the first quarter in the same time.
That it does. End of one, 10-7 Georgia. You don't want to miss the beginning of the second quarter. Trust me, we'll be back shortly. Just about set to start the second quarter, 10-7 Georgia in front. And while we were away, two Tennessee legends took the stage at the end of the quarter. Peyton Manning escorting Dolly Parton.
I just want you to know how proud I am to be here, and thank you so much for taking special attention to do whatever we do. And I had a little trouble with hearing, but we know Rocky Top, and that song was written.
Dolly's got a version of Rocky Top on her new album that I think is called Rockstar, if I'm not mistaken. She just went into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. She is, of course, a member of every country music Hall of Fame there.
I got to believe that. That's Peyton's best scramble of his career.
Peyton had not met Dolly until just before they came out, and he is he's smitten. I'm going to tell you that right now. Back to football we go. First quarter, one snap, a 75-yard touchdown by Jalen Wright. Joe Milton is the leading receiver for Tennessee. That's never a good sign. One for one to himself off a ricochet of his offensive lineman's helmet. And Georgia, 10 straight points. Here's a throw. Now we've got somebody else involved in Squirrel White, and he should have a first down.
Tackling the hitch route. Tennessee's going to take him. They'll probably throw 10 of them in the game. When you can get first down on a hitch route, that is a big success.
Squirrel White comes in, Tennessee's leading receiver. Got the most speed as well. Milton's going to flare it out complete. And brought down at the 30-yard line is Squirrel again, his second catch in a row.
Kirby Smart says getting lined up for this Georgia defense, job one. Make the tackle, get in position, set your cleats.
Tennessee averages about three plays a minute, right around 21 seconds per snap. When they've got things rolling, they got it rolling pretty well right now. Jabari Small, first down, and now they probably will go hurry up again.
Yeah, that was that counter. They love to run it towards the sideline. That way they get that signal. We can't see it. It's being protected by three kind of signs, like black signs being held up. No one can see their signs.
That's right. Milton gonna go deep. Got the big arm, got it out there, and broken up. Intended for Ramel Keaton.
Well, I'll tell you, there was hand fighting on that one.
Amari Lassiter broke it up.
All the way down the field, these two guys were jockeying. The ball goes up, and I think maybe as good a corner as there is in the SEC. Amari Lassiter plays the ball, does not panic, and stays with the play.
So second down and 10. As you see Dylan Sampson to Joe Milton's right into the backfield for the first time for the Volunteers.
When we talked to Joey Hazel, the offensive coordinator, helps Josh Heupel call the plays. He said, we would love a couple 50-ball explosive plays. That's what they were looking for there.
Sampson off the left side, ran into his own blockers. Maybe had he cut back in, he might have had a big gainer. As it is, good run.
They sure got to the edge easily, didn't they?
Yep.
No one even touching them at all. They had trouble last week against Missouri getting to the edge, but easily that time. Tremel Walthour that time just went inside and gave him the edge.
Milton fires high, incomplete.
Had him
for White.
That has been the problem, and I would assume that Tennessee will go for this play. Oh, fourth down. They're going to take him off fourth and three. Usually the Tennessee's very aggressive. Had him open, just threw it high. Remember, that's a fastball.
Yep.
Be aware, if I was Georgia, of defense stays here, whether this, remember, it always looks like a run. Would they go for it with their punt team here?
See which foot Jackson Ross is going to use, his right foot this time. And Makai Muse will take it at the 19-yard line. 13:06 remaining, first half. Georgia in front by a field goal.
Welcome back to Neyland Stadium. You see there on the screen Peyton Manning walking out Miss Dolly Parton, and I am joined by the goddess here herself. Now, you have performed in the grandest of stages all over the world. What was it like singing Rocky Top here in Neyland?
Well, it was great, only I couldn't hear because my sound went out and the stadium was so loud I couldn't even hear it to sing Rocky Top. But I was so honored to be here, and I love Peyton and I love the crowd, so it's just good to be home always.
All right, we're at the line of scrimmage. We're going to see what happens in this next play, and then we're going to continue on with this conversation with you, Dolly.
Carson back on the first down. Throw back, screen, Dylan Bell. Bell got a block, got the edge, got about 15, and back to Dolly.
Oh, Dolly's singing to me. I want them to keep playing so I get a private concert over here.
See, Joey, I could really sing, Rocky Top, you'll always be.
Now, you grew up in Tennessee, about an hour away from here. Why is it so important for you to just hone in on your roots and stay so connected?
Well, it's always great to be home. And, of course, you're right. It's not far from here, up in Sevier County, Tennessee. And, of course, I've got a lot of family still here and a whole lot of friends. And we love UT. So we're always excited when we get to come home, especially, you know, for a ball game.
And we know that you just released your new album yesterday. What was the inspiration behind Rockstar?
Well, they put me in that dang Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and I thought, I got to do something to earn that. I got to do a rock album. So that's what we did, and we had a new package here for the UT fans, you know, with just for the rock album. And then they actually put Rocky Top, my bluegrass version of Rocky Top, as a bonus track. So I was excited about that.
What a way to make a living, Dolly Parton. It is a true honor to meet you. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Jenny Dell with Dolly Parton. This is Kendall Milton for a first down. Boy, you lucky devil, Jenny.
Yeah, and what? While Jenny and Dolly were talking, the Georgia offense has been rolling. rocking and rolling.
Milton, great run there. And a first down at the 46 of Tennessee. Only a yard that time. So Georgia, 300 yards on the ground a week ago against Ole Miss as they really got it rolling. All their backs involved. A 611-yard day in that victory over the Rebels. Milton out, Dejon Edwards back in. Today, their first three possessions, the field goal, the touchdown, and then had to kick it away last time. And now back in Tennessee's end of the field, just outside the 45-yard line. Rosamie Jack Saint, who has the touchdown reception in motion. Beck's looking that way, going that way, got it to him. Still on his feet to the 42. Slaughter brought him down there.
So we've had the pleasure of watching a lot of, you know, high line quarterbacks who want Rensley walk off the field, forcing this Georgia offensive line to adjust. But Carson Beck's throwing motion is pretty, I'll tell you. He was patient, as Kirby told us yesterday. I love it. He said, I've got a quarterback with a chip on his shoulder and an offensive coordinator with a chip on his shoulder, both wanting to prove that they're the right guys for this offense.
They're down at six. Down the middle to Edwards, got the first down and got it to the 32-yard line.
All right, nice chuck down right through the middle of the offensive line. Look down, know you've got number 30, releasing right through the middle. See it open up? Can't help but take him. Know you're down in distance, know you're safe throw. Why force it when you got that easy first down throw?
Dejon with the reception for the first down. He'll go out. Milton comes back in as Georgia continues to rotate those two guys in the backfield. Arian Smith getting a little time at wide receiver. He's down to the bottom of the screen and now in motion. Maybe the fastest player on Georgia's team. They fake it to him. And Beck throws down the sideline to guess who? Brock Bowers, first down at the 11.
Well, we've seen this play so many times. The play-action motion, which allows the wheel route time to come out and come down the field. That allows it, and then you got to gut it in. You cannot lob this ball, and that's exactly what he did.
21-yard pickup. Bowers has got, what, five catches already?
I'll tell you, when you're calling plays, Mike Bobo right now, and you see your quarterback not lobbing any footballs, sticking them in there, you've got confidence to call these plays.
Georgia can get a first down at the one. Beck rolling. He's going to keep it. Heads to the corner to get what he can, which is about 2 yards. And then slips on the turf over there, or on the canvas, rather. So second down and 8.
Trying to get the quarterback involved in the running game. You know who did it well? Stetson Bennett. 3 straight years, he was a guy that hurt this Tennessee team with his legs. 3 of them in a row. There's number 2. That's when you said, hey, this guy's pretty good, right? And then last year, he did it again.
Now it's 2nd down and 8. Back to throw. Got it complete. Dylan Bell, touchdown, Georgia.
This Georgia offense is a machine. They've got about 10 parts that they can use, and a quarterback with the patience to find them, and that 5-man offensive line taking on this Tennessee pass rush and giving them a pocket to say, 1, 2, I'll take my 3rd guy, and he did.
And a 9-yard touchdown, and our AT&T pylon cam has the look from right there. I'm not sure the last time Georgia's had a player that threw a touchdown pass and caught a touchdown pass, but number 86 has done that here in the first half. Woodring's extra point is up and good. So Georgia spotted Tennessee 7 points on the opening snap of the ball game. 17 straight points later, capping an 80-yard drive in 9 plays. Dylan Bell rings up another touchdown from Carson Beck.
Washington undefeated at Oregon State, and we'll see how much Jaden Daniels needs to play against Georgia State for LSU tonight.
Guess you're not getting the Panthers that much credit tonight against LSU there, Zook. Well, CBS Tuesday, head down under for NCIS Sydney. 2 teams of highly trained misfits will come together to defuse naval crimes in the most contested patch of ocean on the planet. NCIS Sydney, new series Tuesday at 8, 7 Central on CBS as the kickoff goes in the end zone. Speaking of misfits, Gene Steratore is with us live and in person. Good to have you along for the ride.
Boy, it's great to be here live, Brad. You know, a thorn between 2 roses, fellas. What can I say?
Right, we bring in Gene and we get 100,000 plus Dolly Parton. Now, that's not bad, right there?
Not bad, Garrett. Not bad.
All right. Well, Gene will be with us the SEC Championship in person as well. And I swear to God, I did not steal your hamburger last night. I promise.
It ended up in your room. That's all I'm saying.
I know. From the 25, this is a run for Joe Milton.
Yes.
And he only got about 3. And C.J. Allen, the freshman linebacker, made
exactly
that.
Exactly what it was, the athletic true freshman C.J. Allen in for Dumas Johnson coming down the line and making that play.
Here's a hand to wrap for Squirrel White. Got some blockers in front, and Squirrel's got a first down. Got out to the 37-yard line before Allen made another tackle. And again, Tennessee will go with tempo here now that they've got their offense moving. Quick throw out in the flat. Dylan Sampson, nice tackle in the open field.
Tyke Smith that time. Watch him take on the blocker. I hope we have this. This is how you handle the quick pass to the outside if you're a safety. Holy cow.
A face mask inside. No call. And the fans thought the same thing I did.
Watch this previous play here. Watch him take on the blocker, knock him down, and then make the tackle. I thought there was a face mask on the last play, and I think they showed it on the scoreboard.
That's why everybody's booing.
Yep.
Hamilton. Milton, rather, and the throw is incomplete, broken up by C.J. Allen.
Yes, he did. He is fast, athletic. You don't get a, well, they're going to call a late flag on this. I wonder if they're going to call an illegal lineman downfield.
Ineligible player downfield. Offense number 10. The penalty is declined. Fourth down.
Squirrel White.
Yeah, that means that they lined up improperly, okay? He's the slot, but both of them are on the same plane right here. Means he's ineligible to go downfield. He's not ineligible until the ball is thrown. That's why the flag came out so late.
Number one, number seven is now 28.
This time, the right foot with a punt. Georgia almost got to that one. And taken by Mekhi Mews. Short return, 3 or 4 yards. Nice job by D. Williams down there to make the stop. Freshman linebacker made a few plays on that series for Georgia's defense. For one of the most iconic moments in this storied rivalry history. Dobbs heaves it. They're bunched up in the end zone. It's tipped up. It's caught. It is caught. Juwan Jennings. Juwan Jennings. Juwan Jennings.
Vern with a call. What a way to end a game. I know Vern and Nancy are watching this game right now.
Two touchdowns in the last 10 seconds is a good ending.
Yeah, that was pretty good in Athens in 2016. Here's Dejon Edwards, a loss of a yard or two.
So the trouble with this Tennessee offense is Dejon kind of limps as he gets up. Tim Banks, defensive coordinator, doesn't feel real confident in blitzing because he doesn't match up well man-to-man with all these different receivers. As you look at Tim, what do you do? I like the blitz, but I don't love my man-to-man matchups.
Milton back in there at tailback. As Gary said, Dejon Edwards kind of limped off on that last play. Brock Bowers in motion on the left side. Back waits and waits and goes down the middle of Dylan Bell. Who's having a heck of a first half.
Just high-level play right there. And I think you're going to might get roughing the passer at the end of the play, too. Kind of went at his knees as he came in and threw it.
73. 10-yard penalty. Remains second down.
They're going to call holding. Oof. Oh, man, I thought he got it in the leg. That's what I thought was going to be called. Roughing the passer as he got into his lower legs, but they called holding prior to that.
That's what Kirby's saying right there. How about Norman Lott in my quarterback's legs?
Yeah, I can see it. Trust that time. Coming off the edge, kind of locked on that holding penalty.
That makes it second down and 21 instead of a first down throw.
Big play for Tennessee. They'd love to get the ball back in this half.
Three wideouts to Beck's right. Including Rosemary Jackson, who's in the slot. It's a wideout screen to Lutter. And we'll get to the 34-yard line. We approach the five-minute mark. And it's third down, Georgia. Would be a big stop for Tennessee right here. Again, Carson back trying to be heard with his offensive front.
Six
third long, here they come. Beck gets rid of it, and caught by Bell. Dylan Bell.
What a game he's having.
He's throwing touchdowns. He's catching touchdowns.
And it's perfect coverage. They bring six. Holy, he's having a Cody Schrader first half here.
Oh, yeah, really.
Milton takes on the blitz, allows Carson Beck to step, and the best team in the country on third down conversion converts another one. They're 5 for 7 in the game.
Dylan Bell doing his Debo Samuel imitation right here in Knoxville. Here's a toss to Milton. Cuts it outside. now back inside and backpedals for about 15 yards. First down for the Dogs.
Mike Bobo is just stealing the plays right now. He gets a corner blitz from the left side of the screen. They're pitching it to the right side of the screen. Perfect call for the defense.
First down at the 38 of the Volunteers. And that's where he'll be dropped, right there at the line of scrimmage that time. And now if Milton goes out, let's see if Dejon Edwards comes back in. He will, so he's all right. Number 30 takes over for number 2. Georgia, almost 20 minutes of possession in this half.
Twice as many plays.
And almost twice as many yards. Even though there was a 75-yard touchdown mixed in there in the opening snap of the ball game. But that's the only score for Tennessee at this point. Beck, deep middle. And Rosamie Jackson has got it at the 5-yard line.
The level of his throwing, the accuracy of these throws. I mean, he's throwing this ball 35 yards down the field to Jack Sain in the middle. Watch where it hits him. He's running full speed, puts it right on him. Not even a half a step off. You can't do it better than that. That was a wide open throw. I get that. But it was a perfect throw on top of it.
34-yard pickup, first and goal, Georgia. Looking to add to their lead from the 4-yard line. Dejon Edwards, a tough yard before he's brought down by Slaughter and company. Quarterback comparison, there is none at this point.
Well, Carson Beck's pitching a perfect game. That third down throw to Dylan Bell, it was remarkable. Perfect coverage. And I said what defensive coordinator Tim Banks says, you know, I don't feel great about my matchups man-to-man. Can't cover a guy any better than that.
Second and goal at the 3. Edwards, the tailback. In motion. Beck comes the other way. Throws to Bowers. Touchdown, Georgia. And it looks simple right now.
So many different players to attack with. They've covered every angle. Bowers is going to slide out. He's going to get a couple picks inside. Call him rubs. Call him just traffic jam. Ball is again placed so that Bowers could catch it and spin into the end zone. Did he get everything across? Pretty close. Pretty close. They're probably going to take another look at this, I would think. Replay probably is looking at it right now. I haven't seen a definitive look where
the ruling on the field, if the touchdown, the previous play is under video review.
This could be short. I think his knee may come down here. Is the ball across the line?
It is. Ball's across.
I think it's easy touchdown.
Well, the balance and the ball control of number 19, knowing that the needed to get the ball across the plane, even if his body wasn't going to get there. And, Gene, that's what he did, right?
He sure did. Brock Bowers reaching with that right arm before the right shin touches the ground. And we know as soon as that ball breaks the plane of the goal line, it's a touchdown. And you can see from our pylon cam a great angle on
Gene, that. The only thing he didn't do there was put his knee pads in for the game.
I don't know where he'd put them, Gary. Looks like they're kind of missing that part of the uniform.
It looks like he's got bicycle shorts on out there. And he pedals his way, bicycle shorts and all.
After video review, the ruling of the field of a touchdown is confirmed.
You know, that's just presence, though, of knowing where you are in the field. I mean, you know you're to the goal line, and you know that you're falling, so reach out, and, you know, you get that ball. All you got to do is touch the line.
He had it well over, tucked in his right arm as they were bringing him down.
That third down throw to Dylan Bell, that hurt Tennessee. They had everything they wanted. Would have got the ball back with, what, 4 or 5 minutes to go in the half, and they ended up converting, don't get the ball back, and giving up 7 points.
It was like a third and 12 as well.
And that was after a penalty, a holding penalty, you know? Yep. I mean.
Well, part of a 71-yard drive, the one that Gary's talking about on third and long, 21-yard strike to Bell. And then it's time to go back to the All-American tight end. His sixth touchdown catch of the year. And Georgia pouring it out here in the first half. See you guys at halftime here. It's 24-7 with a minute 31 remaining in the second quarter. And Carson Beck having a monster day.
You know, Ness, you started off with the credit that Carson Beck deserves, and he does deserve it the way he's playing. Yeah, he's got that guy. But remember the start of the season, the question mark in this whole conference was, where was the quarterback play going to come from? But if you run down the list right now, Jaden Daniels, Jalen Milroe, Carson Beck, right. Graham Mertz at Florida, you know, Brady Cook we saw last week, yeah. Spencer Rattler, really good quarterback play, but Carson Beck doesn't have to take a backseat to anybody. Maybe Jaden Daniels.
Well, maybe. When you have a 600-yard game by yourself like Jaden did last week. Well, working 9 to 5. Our crew's been here well before 9, and we're approaching 5 right now. And since giving up a touchdown on the opening snap, it's been all Georgia.
Yeah, considering they've gone negative yards since the opening run.
And Georgia, meanwhile, field goal, touchdown, punt, touchdown, touchdown. Georgia will get the second half kickoff as well.
75 yards on the first play, and they're at 57 now.
Jalen Wright, who had that touchdown run in the backfield with Milton, who throws wide side, completes, and out for a gain of about 5 is Chaz Nimrod. Nimrod getting more snaps than normal, probably because they lost Dante Thornton last week in the loss to Missouri on his touchdown catch, an injured ankle that'll keep him out the rest of the year. Delayed blitz by Georgia. Milton hangs in, throws complete. This one is Caleb Webb, and he's got a first down.
And that was an area that, you know, this Tennessee team was weak in to begin with the graduation of the receivers last year. Coming back in, we still got Ramel Keaton. Squirrel Wyke has stepped up. We also lost Brew McCoy, obviously, yeah. Early in the year. Plenty of time left, 2 timeouts.
And a minute 3 to play with from the 49-yard line. Milton had to work to the outside, throws on the run.
Had the deep ball that time. Could have gone deep, had a big play. As Joe Milton left the pocket, you always want to look long first. Watch what happens out here. Receiver reverses his field. He's got it for a touchdown.
Going to be shy of the first down by about a yard, I think. And the clock continues to run, but 2 timeouts.
One more look. Watch the end of that play one more time. He has a touchdown throw. I could see it, might not see it, but that was a big possible play there.
Wright's got the first down. And the crowd wondering why they're not throwing here or calling timeouts.
Well,
20 seconds
third and
left.
Short. You got to get the first down. They still have
the result
time.
Of the play is a first down. Timeout. Tennessee.
Now they take the timeout. 20 seconds remaining. Tennessee trying to get some points before the break. Coming up on the Geico Halftime Report, Adam Rick and BJ will have the day's best highlights, including Louisville's attempt to clinch a spot in the ACC championship games. Coming up in 20 seconds.
I think the crowd was reacting that before that second down play, there was a minute 3 to go. They run 2 plays, could have used a timeout there. But I think right now, Josh Heupel saying field goal makes it a 2 possession game.
And that 3rd and 1 was their first down conversion today, by the way. So they're at the 40. They got 1 timeout remaining. 1st and 10. Jabari Small in the backfield with Joe Milton. He will set to throw, and he's going to go deep to the corner of the end zone. Broken up. And would have been an unbelievable catch by Caleb Webb, and he laid out for it, and now he's injured. Dalen Everett, one of the guys covering back there.
Yeah, Everett is, ball would have had to have been perfect. Everett's in, beaten out of phase, really didn't even defend it. It was dropped, but kind of let him out of bounds on the play. Would have been a perfect throw, could have had it.
Yeah.
Would have taken a perfect throw.
Looks like he's going to be up and okay. 14 seconds till half. They took their shot at the end zone, Garen. Now with 14 seconds left, you just try to go down the middle, get a
I think
field goal.
Any positive yards right now, you know, you don't want to kick a 56-yarder. You'd like to get it under 50.
And Charles Campbell's long this year is 49.
You could still go quarterback draw here, too. Oh, timeout, Georgia. They're going to take a look at this. They've got 3 of them.
Timeout, Georgia.
It's Glenn Schumann, a defensive coordinator, talking with Kirby Smart on the sideline. So Georgia had a look at what the alignment was for the Tennessee offense. And we'll see what they do adjusting to that. News and notes around college football. James Madison, so far at least, denied bowl eligibility.
Come on, somebody change the rule, please. Quickly, get him in a bowl game.
Michigan.
Hey, we'd take him in the sun, wouldn't we?
Yeah, come on to El Paso. We'll take you right down there. Washington riding a winning streak into Corvallis. It'll be a big game later on. Here, all Georgia after the opening play of the ball game for Tennessee for their touchdown. Milton. Clock winding. Fires down the middle and
nice
complete.
Catch. Nice throw.
Good throw, good catch. Chaz Nimrod, first down.
Took a timeout, Tennessee. Are they going to go field goal right now, or they try to throw one into the end zone?
Tennessee. Got it in the red zone with that catch against Everett. Nimrod.
Yeah, stepping up. You know, injured players, he's had to come. Nimrod, we've seen Caleb Webb.
21-yard pickup on that one. They put one more second back on the clock.
I think you have time to throw one to the end zone, don't you think?
I would think so, but you don't want to take a sack and you don't want to get intercepted for sure.
Well, when you're behind 24-7, I think you got to gamble and try to get one into the end zone. Yeah, he's telling Joe, you got to throw the ball on time. You cannot risk a sack, and it's got to go into the end zone. Even though he's got that card in front of him, I could see, right?
You could hear exactly what he was saying.
I've heard it before.
Amazing.
Yeah. The other part of it is, when I played, if you get this picked off, you're cut.
You're done.
You're off the team.
Yeah, that's right. We're going to trade you to Cleveland.
Right.
Throw an interception here. So, Joe Milton warming up those hands to throw one more pass, it appears. And now Georgia with a shift on their defensive front. Cooper Mays pointing out who's coming from where and if Georgia's going to bring a blitz.
They take a timeout.
Georgia takes a timeout.
Timeout, Georgia.
So a little cat and mouse game between Josh Heupel and Kirby Smart right here.
I mean, you're going to get a jump ball. You should get a jump ball in the end zone.
That's where they could really use the Brew McCoy. Or Cedric Tillman from last year, some of those guys they've had over time. Emma Stone, Nathan Fielder, and Benny Safdie star in The Curse. Now streaming on Paramount Plus, only with the Paramount Plus with Showtime plan. We'll see what kind of plan.
Got a lot of coaches have here. A lot of defensive brain power there. Kirby Smart, Will Muschamp, Glenn Schumann, you got them all there.
Yep. There's a guy they could use right there for a jump ball.
We remember his big catch after in an Alabama game late, don't we?
Absolutely.
They got six guys back there at the goal line.
Milton has a look to the sideline. Here comes the throw. It's going to be far side and way out there. Almost hit somebody in row one.
That's not taking a lot of risk throwing it that far.
No.
They're going to go field goal. There's the six lined up. That's the Micah Fitzpatrick defense that he talked. Pittsburgh getting to running late in that game, and he goes, no, if I can get cut, this is going to the tuba section.
Charles Campbell will try to hit his 16th field goal of the year. This will be a 37-yarder to give something to the Tennessee offense before halftime. Campbell from 37, and he's got it up and good.
So look, Tennessee, it was bad first half. Had a good play, but they go in saying, all right, we're 14 points down. Let's play 30 minutes and see where we are at the end of the game.
Tennessee scored on the first drive of the game and the final drive of the second quarter. Tapping a 56-yard march in nine plays to get that field goal. Cuts the Georgia margin to two scores. at halftime in Jennings with Kirby Smart.
Coach, Tennessee came out firing. How was your team able to regroup and adjust out there?
Well, we didn't play the first play right. So we came out the next drive and stopped them. And our offense has done a good job possessing the ball, but we had a really sloppy run fit there on the first play.
How do you win each moment in the second half?
Go in here and correct the mistakes, be who we are, and win the line of scrimmage.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Haven't been a lot of mistakes except that opening play.
And they continue to let the guy that's chucking the ball over at a high rate continue to do it, I think. Carson Beck's a good go-to guy.
24-10, our halftime score, as we send you to Adam Zucker in our New York studio with a Geico halftime report.
All right, Ness, Georgia on top and coming along.
The home Duval SEC on CBS heading into the third quarter between the Dogs and the Vols, and Georgia with the advantage. Welcome back, everybody. Brad Nessler, Gary Danielson, Jenny Dell on the sideline. Gene Steratore is up here in the booth with us. 2 hours ago, we made the case that Carson Beck needs a little more love. Maybe he won't have the stats of Bo Nix, Michael Penix, Jaden Daniels. He's hit his last 11 passes for 138 yards and two touchdowns.
No doubt about it. If you would have said prior to the game that Tennessee would hold Georgia to 56 yards rushing in the first half, ooh, they're in the game. But Carson Beck has gone crazy. I mean, let's just admit it. I mean, these throws are pinpoint even when they're covered, even in that last drive. Now, can Tennessee force another punt? Only one in the first half by Georgia.
This kick is returnable for the Dogs, and Dylan Bell, who had a sensational first half himself, with a nice return. He's done a little bit of everything. Now it's time for Duke Project Smarter, presented by the Home Depot.
Well, we talked about when you have a lot of tools, you might as well use all the tools in your project. And boy, as offensive coordinator Mike Bobo used them all, right? Dylan Bell and throwing the ball, catching the ball. And of course, you've got the tool that everybody would like to have. Number 19, Brock Bowers to the outside, but it really has been the quarterback play. No sacks by that offensive line. Remember, that Tennessee pass rush is significant. It's kind of been an all-out Georgia offense.
This guy completing 85% of his passes. First down, Georgia, good field position after that kick return from the 32-yard line. And got in the middle. Up, that was almost an interception intended for Dominique Lovett as we check in with Jenny.
Yeah, Coach Heupel said that we need to have some competitive composure and we need to reset in this one offensively. He said we need to stay on the field, convert third downs, look for some explosive plays out there. Defensively, of course, he said we need to get off the field on third downs. And as far as safety, Jordan Thomas goes, he was injured at the start of the game. He is officially out with a hip injury, guys.
All right, Johnny, thanks. That incompletion by Beck ends the streak of 11 straight that I just mentioned a moment ago. And he's back on the completion line to Brock Bowers. Bowers with a stiff arm, run out of bounds after a short gain.
Yeah, still pretty good, and he comes up limping. Did you notice that?
Yes, I did. That would not be good.
No. Let's see what happens. He kind of gets twisted just a bit on the tackle.
Surgically repaired.
Yep, that left ankle.
Third down and 7. We'll keep our eye on that. Oscar Delp's in for him right now at tight end. And hit time right in the 4 in the hands and incomplete. So 3 and out, just what Tennessee was looking for.
First half, Georgia went 5 for 7 on third down, just what Josh Heupel was saying. They should have made it 6 for 8 except for the drop, an unforced error by Georgia.
That means Brett Thorson to punt for only the second time. And D. Williams, excellent return man, waits on the other end. Again, they have not allowed a punt return all year, Georgia, that is. And fair catch by Williams. So Tennessee got that late field goal in the second quarter on the final play, and then they get the 3 and out. We'll keep our eye on number 19 if he's going to be all right on that ankle. Concern on the Georgia sideline for Brock Bowers, who came up limping after that last catch.
Yeah, they had trainers and medical staff, 5 of them were talking to him.
led by Ron Corson, his long time.
And they're, you know, thinking about both, not only just this game, but his future. I mean, right. He's got a bright future. They're talking to him, and one thing they're saying is, Brock, be honest with us. How does it feel? He's such a competitor.
Quick throw, Milton. Oops. Squirrel White forgot to take the ball with him. Incomplete. Thinking ahead to where he was going, well, right through his hands.
He barely slowed it down.
Second down and 10. Jalen Wright loses a yard. It'll be third and long.
So as Jenner reported, talking to Josh Heupel, third down conversions, 1 for 5 in the game so far.
That won't do it, not against the Georgia defense.
Georgia playing off, 5 across the board, off about 12 yards. Looks like a 3-man rush again.
That is the case, 3-man rush. Milton waits, goes deep, just overshot. Squirrel White again, incomplete. It's fourth down.
So he had all the time in the world. He kind of got to the middle of the field and then goes long. You know, it could have been perfect. Plenty of time to do it. You got to hit one of those. Mm-hmm. I know it's tough. You know, nobody is being critical, but one big play like that could be huge in a game.
Malachi Starks was in coverage for Georgia. Jackson Ross, 4 punts so far, both right-footed and left-footed. This one will be the right. And late fair catch call by Makai Muse around the 30-yard line. 13-17 to go in the third quarter. No change in our score. Georgia 24-10. The Home Depot, SEC on CBS, is sponsored by Papa John's, Google, K, and by Amazon. Early third quarter, Georgia in front 24-10. Brock Bowers is going to stay on the sideline, it appears. Jenny, you got more?
Yeah, other than what you already said about Bowers limping off that field, 5 trainers around him. He did call up to the booth, I would imagine, talking to his OC and quarterback coach in Mike Bobo, now currently on the sideline, so I'll update you on that. But right guard Tate Ratledge is out with a left knee injury, and wide receiver Ra-Ra Thomas is dealing with a right foot injury. He is out for the game as well.
All right, Jenny, thanks. So that means Oscar Delp at the tight end spot for Georgia. End around, Arian Smith, fastest guy on Georgia's team, and he's still going all the way down to the 37-yard line.
Well, Oscar Delp was the guy that was in front that Ness called you. Beautifully designed play, first down, get it to the fast guy, tight end in front, stock block, done perfectly.
A pickup of 33 for Arian Smith. Everybody getting in the act offensively for Georgia, maybe with the exception of the tailbacks haven't had much.
Brock Bowers is back in the game.
And now he and Delp both in there, the two tight end set. They've also got Lawson Lucky, who's an impressive freshman at tight end at times as well. And Kendall Milton, boy, tough yard. That's about it.
Not been able to get that running game going at all. Good job by that front 6 for Tennessee.
Game trends, Dylan Bell's done everything today. Carson Beck, 11 straight completions at one point. 7 times he's hit Brock Bowers today. And the Tennessee offense, a 75-yard touchdown on the first snap and 4 yards of play since. Dylan Bell, a touchdown pass, a touchdown catch. A nice return on the opening third quarter kickoff. And now trying to get something on the ground, and Milton maybe 2 yards. A fired up Tennessee defense knowing that they forced a third down here.
Yeah, good run blitz this time. Watch the linebacker get it right away. Beasley hits it, but then the pursuit from the outside. Good job by the corner coming up making that play, forcing it wide. That's good defense.
Remember, to open the third quarter, they forced a three and out. Let's see if Tennessee's defense can get another. Third down and seven.
Will they blitz? Will they go man-to-man?
On the Tennessee 34, here comes a blitz. Back throws Dylan Bell again.
And that's the problem. That's the problem if you're calling defenses Tim Banks. You know one-on-one you have trouble. Free rusher to the outside, gets it hot, and Dylan Bell gets inside. That's way too easy.
24-yard pickup.
And Georgia's been in the red zone three times and have scored three touchdowns. They're back inside.
And their number tied for number one in the country in the red zone scoring.
And I can guarantee you this, there's not a guy in Tennessee nor a coach that has any idea what play Georgia will run.
First and goal at the 10. Ajon Edwards got a couple. Skirmish going on here after the play. Rob Bowers is involved in it. He's all the way in the checkerboard end zone, and he is upset with somebody.
I don't know who he was teamed up with, but obviously on an inside run, he's got to handle maybe a defensive end type player. Wonder if he was tangling with Pierce out there. Not sure.
You don't see him show that kind of emotion usually unless somebody was after his legs.
Yeah, somebody put him right on the ground. And he did not like it. Yes, that's for sure.
And Oscar Delp pulls him out. One tight end pulls out the other. Meanwhile, a second down and goal at the 8. Carson Beck's got 2 touchdown passes today. Looking for another. Throws it complete. Rosemary Jack Saint, number 3. On the day for Beck. Touchdown, Georgia.
A lot of traffic on this play. Look at the design. The design handles the corner. The man-to-man player. Right here's the man-to-man. But watch the traffic he has to go through. A bump there, then another bump there. That's why he's wide open.
Second touchdown today for number 1. And it caps a 70-yard drive in just 6 plays.
If you try to play man defense down there, you know you're going to get those crossing routes, produce a lot of traffic.
Woodring's point after. Up and good. Wow. A couple of times Tennessee had Georgia in a third down situation, and they just couldn't stop the offense, and they can't stop number 15. 3 touchdown passes on the day. The celebration in the end zone for the Dogs to add to their lead. App State here, 31-10, Georgia. Zirkel to kick. Tennessee will let it go and bring it out to the 25-yard line. Let's take a look at the season that Georgia's had. Trying to go to 8-0 again. No team has finished 8-0 in 3 straight seasons. And that's what they're working for. And with that, let's test your knowledge with today's Aflac trivia question. Which was the last school with 3 straight undefeated seasons in SEC play? Now, didn't involve necessarily 8 games like we were just talking about, but think it over. We'll get back to you. Jalen Wright, there's maybe his best run since his first carry of the afternoon. Picks up 9. If you're just joining us, he went 75 yards on the first snap of the game for Tennessee to give him the touchdown lead. And then Georgia started ripping off points, 24 straight. Milton throws, completes. And across the 40, Chaz Nimrod again.
Well, I don't think there's any doubt now looking at the way this game is breaking, the way Georgia's moving on offense. If Tennessee is going to have any chance, Joe Milton, who's had such a different career, is going to have the best second half of his career.
Yeah. The play fake. Plenty of time. Delivers incomplete, intended for White. And that one's just a misfire as White was open.
Yeah, a little bit of a different look here. Put Squirrel Wright in motion. He got a kind of head of steam and then was able to get across the field. Usually with the wide splits, the Tennessee receivers have a tough time getting from one side of the field to the other. Nice little wrinkle that time, but Joe Milton just missed the throw.
Second down and 10, flags fly.
False start, offense, number 81. 5-yard penalty, remains second down.
Chaz Nimrod, and again, penalties killing Josh Heupel's team on their home turf. Invesco brings you today's Scholar Athletes. Amari Smibbs and Jacob Warm for Georgia and Tennessee. Invesco proud to support student athletes on and off the field with a donation to both Georgia and Tennessee's general scholarship funds. Jacob Warren, a Master of Science. That's after he already got a kinesiology major. See, he's had two head coaches, five position coaches, and the best part, 2 degrees at Tennessee. Good for him. Milton, again, the line holds up for him. Airs it long. Almost intercepted. Squirrel White, the intended receiver, and it was Malachi Starks back there with him.
When you say long, you're saying long. Malachi Starks is back there, safety-type player. Keeps his wits about him, gets up. Kind of almost mistimed it, didn't he? He's coming down for sure when that ball touches his hand.
Joe put some air under that one,
sure
too.
Did. Yeah,
that Tennessee went almost as high as it went deep.
Tennessee with another injury.
And it looks like it's Javontez Spraggins, their right guard. We'll check out him and be back in a moment. And Spraggins being helped to the sideline.
Yeah, sometimes you're just in the wrong spot at the wrong time. Dane Davis, number 66, right tackle, blocked his man right into the back of his leg. Right side of your screen, watch him block him. He's just kind of standing there, and boom.
Ouch. Yep. Third down and 15.
There's that deep look again. Missouri used it last week. Five defenders back about 12 yards off the line of scrimmage.
Third down passing has not been Joe Milton's strength today, for sure. He might not even get a pass away this time. Mykael Williams has got him and drops him back at the 25.
This time it wasn't a three-man rush. This time they brought at least four. Let's see if they bring in five. Yeah, they bring five. They bring six this time, putting the pressure, and they get it. Mykael Williams twisting around and getting in there and forcing another stop on third down.
Loss of 10 forces a fourth and 25 as you look behind Makai Muse as Jackson Ross set to punt it away again. Muse, tough catch at the 30. He made one guy miss and twists his way for about a 2-yard return.
And you said that right. Tough catch. He has fielded everything. He's not going to let that ball hit and roll. Those are like returns just catching them.
Now we asked you the Aflac trivia question a couple of minutes ago, which was
Aflac.
The last school with three straight undefeated seasons in SEC play. Aha. Uh-huh. I think it's a Georgia team. It is. Vince Dooley's teams with Herschel Walker and company, 80-82.
Kirby's old coach, right?
That's right. So Kirby never beat Tennessee as a player, but he's done pretty well as an assistant and a head coach now. As Dejon Edwards got about five. Let's check in with Jenny.
Well, guys, no additional attention from the medical staff on Brock Bowers down here, but I will say Coach Smart said that while he was recovering from his surgery, he was getting phone calls from people telling him that he should sit out the rest of the season, get ready for the draft. It angered Brock. He told me it made him more determined to get back faster, and he said he plays for his teammates and his pride in Georgia, and if he can be out on the field, he's going to be, and you can see that tonight, guys.
Yep, he couldn't wait to get back, and he did it in 26 days, as Jenny reported earlier after that tightrope surgery. Second down and 5. Georgia would like to get something going with their ground game. And almost a face mask on Edwards. Second effort got him 2 more yards. It'll be third down and 3.
So, in Georgia fans in the past, seems to me, you know him better than I do. You're in that area. Have like a love-hate thing with Mike Bobo in the past, right? I mean, you cannot argue the job he's done. Remember all the players they lost off this offense, both offensive tackles, tight end, wide receivers. I mean, he's in quarterback, and he's got them humming.
The last time he was offensive coordinator, the first time around, his last season, they averaged 41 points a game. They're right there right now.
I know, but everybody, you know, when he got the, when Kirby hired, they're like, oh, no. Well, oh, yes.
Yes, that was a pretty good choice. And this guy's a pretty good quarterback so far today. Back, first down, scrambles for it. They'll move the sticks. Herring brought him down, but he got past the marker. Saw that opening right there and said, okay, I think I better do this while I've got the chance.
Good presence again. Play a lot of football, these guys. Got hit right on the side there, but he didn't know exactly where he needed to go.
20 of 25 for 245 and three touchdowns. Kendall Milton behind him, and the pistol set. Rosemary Jack Saint will settle in on the left side. Bowers on the right. And Beck throws. Whoop, got that one too far in front of Rosemary Jack Saint. And couldn't keep his footing.
Made a good catch.
Yeah, he did. He's been a big part today of the offense. I think, basically, when you look at Georgia's receiving core, when you talk about their tight ends and their wide receivers, and they've had some individual guys that were great receivers at Georgia over the years, I think their whole room, if you had everybody together, this is the best group they've had.
I don't think there's any doubt. And remember who's been quiet tonight, Ladd McConkey. We haven't even called his name tonight.
Dylan Bell back in there. He's done everything. Empty backfield. Five receiver group for Carson on second down and nine. Fires complete, and this time it's Muse. So everybody getting in the act.
That's what we were talking about yesterday. Well, people don't know that, but Ness and I were talking about that there are literally 10 different players that will catch passes on this offense. Another little nice little rub traffic route. If it's man-to-man, you know you got that rub to the outside. And Ladd McConkey has not seen the snaps in this game or targets that we're used to.
Remember, he missed four games at the beginning of the year with a bad back and came back in the Auburn game that we had, and he's been a major contributor since up until right now. But everybody else is definitely in the offensive act, including Kendall Milton this time for a nice game.
And again, I think if going into this game, Josh Heupel would have understood that his defense was basically handling the running game. He would have taken his chance.
Yeah.
But it's been like a side note here. I mean, Carson Beck and the pass offense has been so dynamic. It's just, why run?
There's the passing yardage, 274. If you're wondering about Beck's highest game of the year, it was Kentucky, 389.
This is the definition of a slow substitution right here.
Very slow. Carson Beck's going, I wanted to snap it about 10 seconds ago. And now the clock is winding down. They're going to have to hustle to get the snap. Just barely. And Milton struggles to get yardage. Going to be short of the first down.
I was wondering, Gene, how slow can you go? How late can you go? Because that looked like they were taking their time.
Yeah, they sure do, Gary. You know, you give them a reasonable amount of time, but you've got to start watching those defensive players. If they're really, really taking their good old time, the referee can step back, drop it, and you can snap the football there.
Well, this would be a huge third down stop if Tennessee could come up with one.
Hey, I think it might be two down territory, though, if they don't get it.
Dejon Edwards in the backfield with Beck. Love it, the motion man. It's Edwards, first down.
Just hard to get a good shot on him, isn't it?
Yeah, he's slippery.
So you keep, you know, one of those backs, we go, Kendall Milton is the power back, and this guy's the slippery, deceptive runner, and like Dejon goes, I like being the deceptive guy.
Never seems like anybody gets a big hit on it.
Not at all.
Tight end set now as Georgia trying to eat some clock here with under 2 minutes to go in the third quarter. Quick throw, slant, Dylan Bell. Man, 86 is having a game.
Yeah, and right away, right before the snap, pre-snap read, he knew he had one-on-one coverage off to the outside, has an easy pick, easy slant. Brandon Turnage that time, kind of a half safety, half corner. Remember, this team has lost a couple corners. Kamal Haddon, one of their best cover guys, is not playing.
Another 19-yard pickup. Dylan Bell, quite a day.
Fifth time inside the red zone, four touchdowns so far.
Kendall Milton cuts it outside, a stiff arm, and a Georgia touchdown. Kendall Milton from 15 yards out.
Dominic Lovett, the slot, did a good job on the left side. Watch when Milton gets out there. Dominic Lovett, number six, stock block. You can see him to the top. Just enough to spring Kendall Milton.
And from the AT&T pylon cam, Kendall Milton backpedals in for the touchdown.
Well, when we come back, I mean, is this enough of a show that Georgia going into the national, into the SEC championship, win or lose? Are they in the playoffs?
Wow, they look pretty good, don't they? 68-yard drive and 10 plays. Kendall Milton's eighth rushing touchdown of the year, and it's 38-10. A tough game. So's Carson Beck having a really tough game here. Joe Milton has had a tough game. Gets it out. Jabari Small and a little screen to the outside. Got it to the 29-yard line. Well, Heisman contenders, as Adam just talked about. Bo's having a big game. Jaden Daniels, unbelievable game a week ago with 600 yards of offense by himself. Michael Penix has put up big numbers. Marvin Harrison Jr., of course, the receiver for Ohio State, having a super year. But, you know, if it was just best player, I think Brock Bowers would be involved. I think this guy would be involved.
Well, and Jaden Daniels, obviously, even though they've got, what, three losses.
Yeah. Yeah, what he's done has been spectacular. Squirrel White on the
don't
completion.
You have the feeling, though, it's going to come down to that Washington-Oregon game? I mean, what would that?
Probably.
Seems like it.
Yeah. And the third quarter will come to a close before Tennessee snaps it. And a three, 38-10. As my man Kenny Chesney would say, young, and just young. It's good to be young. It's good to be a Bulldog right now.
Coach Mark, now Coach, it is obvious that Brock Bowers is not at 100%. What does that say about his fight out there continuing to lead this team?
Well, he said he's 100%. I asked him five times. But he's doing a great job, and I think he's healthy. He's competitive. He's giving us everything he can. He's just such a great kid.
Thank you so much, Coach.
Thank you.
Big smile on his face on the sideline as the fourth quarter starts, and Georgia in command at 38-10. Tennessee shaded just on their side of midfield, and Joe Milton on a quarterback draw, and that's going nowhere as Tyron Ingram Dawkins brings him down for a loss.
Yeah, those stout inside defensive tackles, they got a lot of experience inside. Strong, stout, take on their guys, don't give up a lot of yardage.
You don't give up much right there either. Third down coming up. Jordan Hall made that stop along with C.J. Allen. So last week was the lowest point total as a head coach for Tennessee, for Josh Heupel, with just 7 in their loss to Missouri, and right now they're stuck on 10. Jacob Warren, the tight end, with the catch. And right in front of Kirby Smart is short for the first down. He had to come back for it a little bit. He ran his pattern right at the marker, and then when he came back to make the catch, he ended up that much short.
Fourth down play, and I don't think they have the right package in the game They're looking over to the sideline. Are they going to have to take a timeout? Because right now the Tennessee players are all looking at the bench.
I think they want him.
He's going to have to take it. Had the wrong substitution.
I don't know if they wanted six linemen in or they didn't have what they were looking for, but it cost them a timeout.
It's football time in Tennessee.
Jalen Wright, big opening off the right side. Touchdown, Tennessee. We roll to the right. Bell to throw a touchdown pass. Yeah! Dylan Bell. And Beck will dump it off. Short man Bell. He breaks the tackle at the six. Into the end zone. Touchdown. Beck rolls right. Throws Beck with a scoop catch at the two. Did he get in? Yeah! Touchdown. Some of the highlights are IHG Hotel and Resort game recap. Good news if you're a Tennessee fan, the first snap was exciting. Since then, it's been Georgia pretty much rolling 38-10 right now, and they look like a machine, Gary. Let's be honest.
They do. They're the number one team in the country. They deserve it. You know, you think maybe the pressure of doing it for a third straight year, but I got the feeling they can see the finish line.
Yeah.
You know, you get their second wind, and you're a runner. You get that right towards the end. You used to be
slow.
A runner.
I used to be a runner. That's right. 1 foot in front of the other right now.
You got it.
Let's check in with Jenny.
Well, I just double-checked with Georgia personnel to see what was going on with Ladd McConkey. We haven't seen much of him. He actually got stiff in this game, so coach is going to sit him for the rest of the game. Remember, guys, he has been dealing with those disc issues in his back all season long.
Yeah, it was a bad, you know, not a feeling you would expect to see Ladd McConkey not get any targets.
Right.
He had to figure something was wrong.
Well, there's how much Tennessee needs for the first down. Got a full house backfield and a 6'5 quarterback under center. But they will hand it to Jabari Small, and he got the first down. Didn't get much more.
No, he did.
Malachi Starks.
Yeah, Malachi Starks. I mean, usually, except for the first play of the game, with that long run where the safeties missed the tackle, this is what you usually see from Bullard, Starks, and Smith. High-level tackling from those three guys.
So the first down keeps this going for Tennessee in Georgia territory at the 39. Milton airs it to the end zone, in and out of the hands of his intended receiver, Chaz Nimrod.
How about that play by Javon Bullard? Stayed with the play. He was beat, and then just a bit of an underthrow, and watch him pop the ball out with his right hand.
Yep.
What a play. Again, you know, you have the tendency to try to grab a guy, but Bullard puts his left hand on there, but his right hand makes the play, and I think that's why he got away with it. The official said, good play, I'll give it to you.
Jabari Small slipped on his own. I think they're going to bring this back for a loss of one. I thought his knee touched before he continued to run. And he looks a little gimpy getting up, too. And there, he's asking to come out.
Yep, he is. You're right.
Nobody's listening so far. So it's another third down and long situation.
Usually your backup, Jabari Small, you know, Jalen Wright, Sampson would be looking at him. Yeah, that ball should have gone back farther. You're right.
Milton flushed. Running for his life and throwing it away. Incomplete, out of bounds. Tyke Smith was the guy that was chasing.
Well, of course, Tennessee will go for it on fourth down here.
Tonight over on CBS Sports Network, Mountain West Mayhem with Boise State and Utah State getting together at 7 Eastern, followed by San Diego State on the road against San Jose State. All tonight on CBS Sports Network. Here's fourth down.
Well, they're going to go field goal. Wow.
And that'll be Charles Campbell. This will be about the extent of his range for sure.
Kirby,
it's going to be a 55-yard attempt. He made five 50-yarders. 50-plus when he was at Indiana before transferring in. This would be his longest as a volunteer. Kick on the way, and it's going to be off to the left. No good.
Yeah, I don't quite get that one. I thought for sure. I said, of course, they would go for it. You know, you got a 31-10 game. I don't know what 13 gives you. I would have gone for it.
Field goal, no good. Score remains in Georgia's favor. In big numbers, 38-10. The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by Invesco QQQ. Jersey Mike subs. Liberty Mutual Insurance. And by Wheels Up and Delta Airlines. Neyland Stadium in Knoxville, fourth quarter. 53rd matchup all time between the Georgia Bulldogs and the Tennessee Volunteers with Gary Danielson, Jenny Dell, and Gene Steratore. I'm Brad Nessler. Coming up later in the game, before we're done, it's the play of the game presented by Jersey Mike Subs. There are no subs out there for Georgia right now. They got so much depth that just about everybody plays equal amount of snaps. And they've got a 38-10 lead. Oscar Delp is in at the tight end spot, but he's in there a lot. Brock Bowers, maybe his day is done.
Yeah, he could tell me 10 times he's healthy. He's not going back in.
Carson Beck's been sensational today. Loads and fires. That one's tipped. Incomplete. Somebody got a hand on it en route. I think it might have been Jeremiah Thielander.
I think you're right. 22. Inside linebackers in that crossing zone area. Again, that ball is ripped. There's no putting the air under those crossing routes for Carson Beck. He's throwing fastballs.
I'm thinking Thielander's hand hurts right out there after that one. But he did make a nice play defensively. Georgia fans that have made the trek to Knoxville, happy group right now. Ball on the ground.
Second time, poor ball handling. This one's going to go to Tennessee.
And it's between Milton and Beck.
And last one was too.
Yeah, it was.
Remember when they got it back last time, this was a very similar looking play going the opposite direction.
Their mesh points off, that's for sure.
Yes. Oh, it's the snap was bad. It had nothing to do with the ball handling.
Van Brand hit himself in the rear end, I think.
Yeah, you know, it was almost like he was trying to hold on to it, like he didn't know if he knew the snap count, like he was trying to double clutch. Oh, the ball slipped right out of his hands.
And then was kicked, and that's why it made it look like it was a handoff.
We're trying to figure everything out.
Yeah. A little bit of mayhem at the line of scrimmage, so a Georgia turnover gives Tennessee a shot here at the 34-yard line. And that was an ugly play as well, and it might involve the center. Flags are down.
False start. Offense, number 53. 5-yard penalty, remains first down.
Call that one on Jeremiah Crawford.
So let's talk a little bit about this Tennessee offensive line. I mean, both starting tackles are not playing in this football game. Left guard, Ollie Lane is in. That's usually rotated. Vondre Carrick. But now Scroggins is out, the right guard. I mean, it has just been a disaster up front for this Tennessee offensive line.
Throw and catch to the 30-yard line. Goes the other tight end, McAllen Castles. It's his first catch of the day. Tennessee trying to hurry up here with just under 12 minutes to go. Second down and 6 at the Dogs 30. Play fake to Jalen Wright, and the fire complete to the 12 line.
Impressive play by Joe Milton that time. I think he had Chaz Chambliss right in his face as he let this ball go. Watch how accurate it comes in. Fastball, squirrel inside.
To the 20-yard line. Nothing doing for Jalen Wright that time. Got back to the line of scrimmage if he's lucky. And Zion Logue, one of the captains of the defense, with a stop. Been a long night for Smokey. Not much to bay about. And it's a little bit cool, too. You got to have a wrap. A long day. Saw Smokey out warming up with the team before the game. Getting a little running in. Running out of time. Smokey's team right now. Milton throws complete again. It's Castles, and he's got a first down inside the 10. First and goal, Tennessee.
Taking the easy throw, four-man rush. Little ball action play. Gives it to the tight end, slipping out to the side.
First and goal at the 8. Jalen Wright got only about a yard. And this time it's Nazir Stackhouse on the inside, and another lineman down. Davis
Yeah, Dane Davis was in, subbing for Gerald Mincy, and that Davis goes down now.
They're going to run out of tackles in a second.
Holy cow.
10-19 remaining fourth quarter. Check on Dane Davis when we come back. Davis being helped off. 6'7", 325 pounds.
Exactly, exactly what happened to Spragans. This time Stackhouse is thrown into Davis, just standing there from behind, falling on his right ankle.
You can have all the braces in the world.
Right.
Doesn't withstand that. Let's take a look at our Ford game changer. This guy's done everything. Dylan Bell throwing a touchdown. Dylan Bell.
That's the play.
Beautiful pass.
Play of the game. That's
21-yard pickup on 3rd and 12.
Really feel if Tennessee had any chance on that third down play, they needed to get a stop, and it was too good of a pass.
Dylan Bell doing everything today. That didn't even include nice kickoff return and special teams. Second down and goal at the 10-minute mark from the 7. Jalen Wright tripped up. Oh, boy.
Caught from behind.
Nice play by Tyke Smith.
Yes, he did. A little more pressure this time from the safeties. Motion goes across. The safety stays and then runs it down.
Tyke Smith, who was a freshman All-American at West Virginia. And then he was an All-American as a sophomore, transferred to Georgia, went through a lot of injury problems, and now playing at the top of his game in that Georgia defense. Third down and goal. Milton the throw out in the flat, but the Dogs are there to stop it. It'll be fourth down as Nimrod makes the catch, but only picked up about 2 yards.
Remember the crossing routes that Georgia ran for man. Will Georgia go man, or will they step back and try to play a zone to keep everything in front of them?
Tennessee's 1-for-1 on fourth down today. This is the biggest one. Fourth and goal from the 4. Milton. Whoa. Smoked one into the back of the end zone looking for an interference call. Was Chaz Nimrod and his head coach, and neither gets it.
I thought they could have called holding on this play before the ball was thrown. It's right here, CBC holding on the play. Grabs him, turns him. I don't know, it seemed like he had his hand all over him on the play.
Georgia takes over on downs. The ghost that launched a worldwide phenomenon have jumped across the pond and landed on CBS. And hey, we say cheers to that. See why they're big believers in ghosts, UK ghosts, and haunting us Thursday at 9, 8 Central on CBS. Was that a ghost holding call, Gene, on that last play?
You know, Brad, there was a hook there, as Gary mentioned, right at the top of when the receiver turns in. When you watch it, you see Martin kind of put the hook on him. And now as he goes backward, you'll see that right hand, it even kind of stays on his backside. And then he keeps it there, and he kind of grabs his back of his pants to keep him tight in the play. Definitely rises to a level of a defensive hold there. Could have been pass interference with the ball in the air.
So you're saying two holds and a pass interference?
I think it was a couple, of, you know, a half, a half, a half, gets you one and a half.
Other than that, he didn't do anything wrong.
Jeez. Thanks, Gene.
Kendall Milton on the carry for Georgia as we're under 9 minutes. I asked you during that last time out, do we see Brock Vandergriff? But it's still Carson Beck.
Yeah, guess where the ball is right there. Doesn't want to put Vandergriff in a bad situation. You know, make a mistake.
The receivers.
Everybody else is in the number one crew.
There's what the receivers have done today. And they aren't only three guys, just the highest numbers statistically. Milton moves the pile. The Georgia offense moves the pile.
And then the Tennessee defense moves the pile.
And forward progress, I think he's going to be about 2 yards shy of the first down, I believe. Well, Georgia getting ready for some history to match a couple of Alabama teams at 28 straight.
I really didn't think those things would be approached with the modern-day transfers.
Yeah.
NILs that you can go out and add to your team, but this Georgia program, and thinking, you know, there are other things. I mean, second and 26. All of the things that could have happened since the first year of Kirby. I mean, it's been excellence since that first rebuilding year.
Georgia has won 43 of their last 44 games.
Just amazing.
And here comes Andrew Paul getting a carry here in the fourth quarter.
Wouldn't be surprised to get a curtain call now for Carson Beck, to tell you the truth, anytime.
Brock Bowers' day is done. Oscar Delp and Lawson Lucky will carry the load as the tight ends the rest of the way. Delp, number four, right in the middle of your huddle.
Really want to go back to Mike Boba, the job he's done with this team. You know, Tom Monken, really number one, the Royals Award, you know, assistant coach of the year. I think he's got to be considered, the job he's done.
He's on the list so far.
I mean, way considered, way up there. Did they invite him to New York or something like that?
I don't know where they go.
You know, the finalists.
Sure.
Get one of those trips.
I think you go to Arkansas, to be honest with you. Pretty sure it's Fayetteville. Now, there's nothing wrong with Fayetteville. I like Fayetteville.
I know. I get it.
They're down in two.
You know, Todd Monken done such a great job, and no fall off at all.
Georgia's consistency on both offense and defense. Sixth in the country in scoring, sixth in the country scoring defense. Can't do much better than that. Might be Carson Beck's last pass if indeed he throws it. He does, and it's right on target, as all of them have been today, it seems. Jackson Meeks for the first down for the Dogs.
Yep, same play all day. Good protection, one-on-one coverage. They cannot handle the receivers. And how many different players have caught a pass here for Georgia? Eight?
Been a bunch. Seven or eight, anyway.
Seven or eight. I'd say eight.
Carson Beck on that 300-yard pace again, which he's hit five times, and if he does throw another pass complete, he'll be past that again.
Pretty sure they'll be running the ball here.
Yep. So we close in on 5 minutes. And this will be for Georgia, if this all holds up, which it looks like it will, their seventh straight win over Tennessee. And it's Cash Jones. Nice run. A lot of things could still happen, but Ohio State pounding Minnesota right now. Georgia's about to go to 11-0. Michigan had all they could handle from Maryland today. Northern Alabama playing Florida State, Oregon State, and Washington. That'll be interesting tonight.
Yeah, it will. It will.
Be watching that one on the bus.
We will be doing our last bus ride. We'll be enjoying it. Everybody has been substituted out now except for 15. I got to believe he's going to get a curtain call after this handoff.
Second down and two. And a first down run again by Andrew Paul.
More subs coming in. Two at a time.
Carson Beck looking over to the sideline.
Everybody's getting a handshake for a job well done.
Those big fellas up front getting a pat on the back.
And as we knew from the beginning of the year when we were looking at the schedule, we knew this game against Tennessee would be the game that they would tie the record, right? So we had it circled, and then, boy, the original knocked down that long run. I went, oh, holy
cow. And it's been all Georgia since. Toss sweep and a loss of a yard. We work our way down to 3 minutes. Coming up on the U.S. Army postgame show, Adam, Rick, and BJ with the day's best highlights and their impact as the season comes down the home stretch.
Here comes Brock Vandegrift, and there goes Carson Beck for one more handshake.
And a job extremely well done by Carson Beck. What a day. You saw his numbers a moment ago, just under 300 yards passing, three touchdowns, no interceptions, although there was an interception that was called back because of a holding. So an almost perfect day. His quarterback rating off the charts right now. and Paul on the carry.
As Kirby
Let's take
said,
a look at what he's done today.
Had a chip on his shoulder. He had to wait his turn. Lost the battle to Stetson Bennett not to be the quarterback. Stayed, knew he's going to have a good team around him. Kind of smart to stay at Georgia, if you ask me. Have these players in this offense, and it has paid off.
So Georgia fans go from, can he be the guy, to I hope he comes back.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
We'll have to wait and see, but his season's been sensational. Third down and nine for Brock Vandergrift, who's in relief of Carson Beck. And they'll keep it on the ground. Andrew Paul again. That'll bring up a fourth down situation for Georgia. Carson's final numbers look like this. Third game with three or more touchdown passes. His high was four against Kentucky, but you can't beat those numbers right there. And he is 11-0 as a starter. As Georgia about to be 11-0, they've got a date with their in-state rivals. They'll actually have back-to-back weeks in Atlanta, so it's next Saturday night against Georgia Tech and the following Saturday afternoon against Alabama. And we'll, of course, be there to bring you that SEC championship. Look out! Brock Vandergrift nailed by Aaron Beasley on the blitz.
Well, good for Tennessee. Hang in there, finish the game. I mean, you never want to be on tape not finishing the game. You got your brothers watching you. You don't like to be see anybody dogging at the end of the game.
He's had some high moments playing in Jacksonville against Florida. A great game there in his hometown. And now an 11-0 start and 11 wins as a starter.
You know, Joe Milton back in the game. I'm sure some Tennessee fans wondering why they wouldn't put in their five-star true freshman Nico Iamaleava in the game. Remember, it has to do with redshirting. Right. He's already played in three games. If he plays in a fourth, he can't play next week against Vanderbilt. So the plan is going to be not play here in real garbage time, and maybe he'll get some playing time next week. Remember, the bowl game doesn't count.
Right.
So he can get an extra game in the bowl game.
Very high on him, one of the highly touted tight end, or quarterbacks in the country a year ago. Down to 30 seconds remaining as Cameron Seldon, a true freshman, gets some work at tailback.
Big recruiting weekend for Josh Heupel. Maybe last year with their season they had with Hendon Hooker, maybe a half step ahead of plan. This was a bit of a setback, I think, the Tennessee fans, and I think even Josh Heupel thought he would have a little better year than they've had.
Well, Georgia's still perfect. 11-0, 8-0 as they run the table in the regular season in conference play for the third straight year. And 28 straight wins for the Bulldogs. Celebration begins here and in Athens and all over the state of Georgia. 38-10, the final score. We'll have final comments when we come back. The final, 28 straight wins for the Georgia Bulldogs. The winning coach and some of the stars of the game with Jenny Dale on the field. Jenny.
All right, Coach, 28 straight wins. They just set it up there. You're tying the all-time SEC record. What is the winning formula for this program? You keep doing it.
Sign good players, sign good kids, and get them to believe that if they don't care who gets the credit, if they don't care who gets the credit, that they'll be very successful. And we got a group of guys here that, you know, it's different every week. This guy didn't get a whole bunch of touches the last week, but today he made a bunch of big-time plays. He got his opportunity, and this guy helped him do it.
He did make some big plays out there, a receiving touchdown and a passing touchdown. Which one was more fun for you?
I had to say the passing touchdown.
I told him, don't overthrow him.
Did you know that call was coming your way?
Not at that moment, but when it came, I mean, I was like, why not, you know? So, yeah.
Can I go and let you have them?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Go Dawgs.
All right, Carson, come on over here. You think about this offense, and as a collective group, it is just incredible in so many different facets. How much of a luxury is it to have so many weapons like this guy and so many other players?
Yeah, I mean, I've continuously said it all year that we have so many guys on the offense that can make explosive plays, step up in big-time games like this, especially on the road in the SEC, and obviously he did a great job tonight.
And you think about the history that you guys are making, tying the all-time SEC record at 28 wins. When you think about that number and all the players that have come through, where does that really resonate with you?
I mean, obviously it's 1 week at a time, 1-0 every single week. I know that's super cliche, but we got to keep it like that. You know, we're not worried about a streak. We're worried about each and every week coming in, getting a win, and then we'll move on to the next.
Congratulations.
Thanks so much.
We'll see you at the SEC Championship.
Well, they'd probably like to win about four more, and that would give them three straight titles, unprecedented, unless you talk about the Gophers of the 30s. And now it's time for the play of the game, presented by Jersey Mike's Subs. And one of our stars of the game, who Jenny just talked about, doing a little bit of everything. And this, he said, was his favorite play of the day, his touchdown pass. Scott Howard called it like this for Georgia Radio Network.
Delp is in as one of the tight ends. We roll to the right. Bell to throw a touchdown pass. Yeah! Dylan Bell!
What a
took the carry. Z out of the, went to the right side and chunked it into the end zone. Marcus Rosemy, Jack Saint caught the touchdown pass from Dylan Bell.
Last guy to catch a touchdown and throw a touchdown, probably Charlie Trippi or somebody like that.
That's
I don't
a
know.
Good name. So over the last 2 years, the word was an elite defense led him to a championship. I don't think there's any doubt Georgia has an elite offense, and we'll see if that can carry them to another championship.
The only two people that aren't happy other than the 100,000 or so here, Peyton Manning and Dolly Parton. Dogs are happy, though. That's going to wrap it up for Gary Danielson, Jenny Dell, Gene Steratore, our entire CBS crew. Brad Nessler saying so long, excuse me, from Knoxville. Final score, 38-10. Georgia, 28 straight wins. We'll send you back to Adam Zucker and company, the U.S. Army postgame show, right after these messages. Good night from Rocky Top.